Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. I'm Brother Mandene T. Muhammad. Welcome you to another edition of the Munir Muhammad Show, a CROE media production with you in mind. I was excited to be able to be a part of a operation to provide a platform for those that come on to get a chance to express their thoughts and ideas, and hopefully you walk away more informed than you were prior to watching the show. This is a live interactive show. The number to call in is 773-434-6625. Again, that's 773-434-6625. If you're checking us out on the various social media platforms, including Facebook, please like and share the broadcast there. Also on YouTube, please like, share, and subscribe so you'll be notified each and every time that we go live. And program note, since it's election, we have been going live on Fridays now, so this Friday will be no different. We have Representative Mary Flowers, and we have a young man coming on about the Bring Home Chicago bill that's taking place. So make sure you check that out at 6 o'clock this coming Friday. Also, I want to thank everyone that supported us this past March the 10th for our 37th annual Founders Day, one major fundraiser that we have a year. So I want to make sure that I thank everyone that came out, those that... there's a lot going on that night. They probably didn't get a chance to make it out, so we do understand. But let me say this, though. Although the event itself is over with, there's no expiration date as far as donations. So please, by all means, go back to that CROE page and make that donation. Donate as much as your little heart desires. So we and the reason why, and all jokes aside, the reason why, before I come to my guest, you have to support independent platform, an independent voice like what we have here. We've been doing this close to 30 years now. It allows people to come on and get their message out, but you can't do that at the other stations. They'll talk to you for an hour, and you may get 30 seconds worth of your message out there. Here, we'll answer that. You make sure you get your questions answered, give you a chance to talk. We're not going to just let you say anything. We will push back and challenge you. But, at least you have that opportunity to do so. So please take in consideration of supporting CROE, the archives here, and CROE Media, what we do here. So with that being said, my first guest this evening has been very patient, and I appreciate her coming back to the Munir Muhammad Show, the clerk of the Circuit Court of Cook County, Ms. Iris Y. Martinez. Welcome back, ma'am.
Also happy to be back.
How are you doing this evening?
Well, I'm doing great. I'm going to have a great conversation with you.
Yes, ma'am. You look, for somebody that's in the thick of it, only got a few days left before the 19th, you look refreshed.
refresh ain't the word. I'm probably going to sleep for 24 to 48 hours after this is all over.
I do understand. I do understand. But how are they treating you out there on the campaign trail with the people that are the most important?
You know what? It's been, I love campaigning. I mean, you come across, so many people and they talk to you about things that are going on. And these last 3 years and a half that I've been at the clerk's office, this new job, it's been a very rewarding, but, there's been days when I'm like, what was I thinking? Mm-hmm. But I know that at the thick of things, at the end of the day, it's about making sure that we're providing the best services, the best resources we can for all the people of Cook County. Because,
yes,
that office is very important. It's a judicial system that, that everybody will one day access for whatever reason. It's a place that we have to make sure that it's running smoothly, that the technology is at its best, that the services, people are coming into our courthouses are getting the respect, are being treated correctly, and that the information that they're looking for is always made available. And that's been a challenge because, the technology is something that, it's evolving every single moment. Mm-hmm. And you have to know exactly what it is that you're doing in order to make sure that the information that you're inputting or that information is information that is correct and it's accurate because, our records have to be accurate, especially for our judges who have to access them every single day in the courthouses and everything else. So.
And before we go to that, I just want to, for those that may not be familiar, because you didn't just pop up out of nowhere. You have a track where you've been doing, you've been a public servant for 40 years. So
40 years.
A lot of people have been alive, especially some of these voters out here. So what I want you to do, give us a cliff note version. Walk us through that history that you have as being a public service.
Well, great. I started, over 40 years ago. I started to work for the city of Chicago. Started there under Mayor Daley, mm-hmm. and then went over to Springfield to lobby the bills of the city bills, and got the bug out there about mm-hmm. wanting to run for higher, you know, for office, and Senator Miguel Del Valle, who was, you know, the very first Latino that ever, you know, served in the Senate, said to me, Iris, we need to for you to run. And I was like, no, you know what, I'm good behind the scenes, you know, I will do all that. But he goes, no, you need to step to the forefront. You have a story to tell. You live in a neighborhood, you're a single mom, you've gone through a lot of, you know, a lot of challenges. And that's what people need to hear, that voice in Springfield. And so, you know, I thought about it, and as a single mom, I was saying, you know, I'm gonna be, have to be, you know, give up my job for 3 or 4 months to run a campaign, you know. And, but I went and talked to the mayor. The mayor says, you know, go and know that you have the job, win or lose. And that gave me the comfort that I needed, you know, as a single mom, because I had a mortgage, you know. I went, you know, to Springfield. I mean, I went on the campaign trail, and I won the election. I'm the very first Latina ever to elect, you know, be elected into the, in the history of the state Senate. So that was that was quite an accomplishment, you know. Left there about 3.5 years ago, I finally retired. But, you know, leaving the place and seeing 4 Latina women in the state Senate made me feel a whole lot better, because when I got there, I was the very first, I was the one and only for many, many years. Yeah. I did it by myself. Then I, you know, decided, you know, and when I decided about the clerk's office, it was because as a senator, I would hear people come in and complain about the clerk's office, about the lack of, you know, of services, the lack of correct information, paperwork being lost, you know, people saying they were rude to them, you know, going in there. You hear a lot of that, and, you know, you, in the back of your mind, you think, you know what, you know, I still have energy, I still want to do something, you know, and I took a chance. I was in the, and I was in the term, I was midterm in my, and I said, well, you know what, if I win, you know, I will make sure that my next successor, I pick my next successor, you know, or if I lose, at least I can finish out, because I was planning to retire after 20 years in the state Senate. I said, you know, I was going 20 years and that was going to be it. And, you know, we won the seat, you know, I turned the seat over to a young lady, and, you know, I started my, you know, my I call it my adventure in the clerk's office, where, you know, where there was a lot, you know, I came in the middle of COVID. COVID, December of 2020. We were in the heart of it. And coming in, the office was empty. There was not, you know, too many clerks there. A lot of everybody was at home trying to get everybody back. But my first thought was, we got to get them back where they can feel safe in a healthy environment. We had to redo that office, as far as there was so much clutter. There were so much boxes and clutter and so much stuff. We had to clear all that out and start, you know, start separating these desks, making sure that people had their own space with the plexiglass and everything, so we can make sure they can come back and feel that they were, you know, that they were, that their health was being taken under consideration, and that we were, it was at the forefront, of the of when I first started the administration. You know, you get back. We had to set up all the Zooms, you know, Zoom calls, because the judges were not going to come back. Right. Our clerks had to be back because the judges were working from home. So we had to make sure that all the Zoom, you know, the logistics had to work well because of the fact that, you know, people were still, you know, going to court. You know what I mean? Right. So, but, you know, from the privacy of their own, the judges from the privacy of their home, and of course the people are not, you know, at home also going to these. So there was a lot of things that we had to put in place, a lot of foundation that we had to really lay. There was not even a real HR there, which I had to, and of course I walk in, the HR, what do I find? We are under the Shackman, there's a Shackman lawsuit. So we had to come in and work with the federal monitor, make sure that we are following every step of the employment plan, you know, that we had to establish with them. And 18 months later, I was dismissed from that lawsuit, saving the taxpayers of Cook County millions of dollars, because that was a very expensive lawsuit. That, you know, we worked on that. And then, of course, then we started to look at all the things that were going on. We saw backlogs. We saw about 6,000 applications of expungements that were never acted on. So people that filled them out thought they were being processed. They were just sitting there. So we had to work on that backlog. I can tell you that we have brought that backlog to maybe less than 100 already. We also saw a big backlog in warrants, old outstanding warrants that were in the system for over 5 years. We had to deal with that. We're down to practically nothing. We had a warrant program. We made sure we brought in staff. We brought people, and finally, all those warrants have finally been, you know, caution recall. And so we've been able to at least, you know, take care of that. So, and then of course, you know, hiring. We had to hire. We had a deficit of, you know, of employees there. We had about 300 vacancies there, you know, and trying to bring people back, you know, in 2021 and 2022 was not very easy, because people were still feeling, oh, I want to work from home, I want it from home. We can work from home. Right. Our courts need to be open. There's got to be somebody there to take care of the judge, regardless if he's in the courtroom or he's at home. or wherever he may be, right. We had to make sure we provided that. So that alone was, you know, very an undertaking. But we right today to this day, 3.5 years later, we've already employed over 500 and about 20 or 30 new employees. Mm. 450 of them are union jobs, which is, you know, the clerks. And I was able to also establish within the clerks, collapse some of these titles. I mean, there was like 1,000 titles in that. We were able to collapse, and now there's upward mobility for our clerks to be able to go ahead and bid on, you know, on higher paying jobs, yeah. More responsibilities than just get clerks. You got office clerks, you got courtroom clerks, you got clerk trainers. So now they have opportunities to move around and be, and I, you know, the clerks have to be treated the best in every courtroom because they're the ones that maintain our courthouses. Right. You know, they're the ones that really run the show. And to me, making sure that they're paid well, that they're well taken care of, that they're in a safe environment was important. Then I started going around, looking at the different courthouses, see what the needs were. Down in Markham, what did we find? We find that there was an empty space down in the concourse level, and we were able to open our very first domestic violence center, mm-hmm. you know, for Markham and the Markham courthouse, because the Southland did not have a domestic violence center that people can access. And we saw this because we saw people out in the open, you know, with bruises on their face, filling out paperwork to order for protection out in the open. I wanted something private and for them, very personal, and for their children that they would bring and fill out. We have a real beautiful room down there where we have a big TV that all the judges donated, where the Nickelodeon is running all day for them. But at least it's entertaining. We got food for them there. We got books. We have, you know, all kinds of little materials for the kids to entertain, and they're more than welcome to take them home with them, you know, when they leave. So, you know, the judges there are so happy because they know
that. You mean a nice safe space.
A nice safe space. And you know what? The orders of protection. I mean, since COVID, those numbers have been, I mean, and they haven't slowed down. Yeah. The orders of protection are coming in on a daily basis by the big numbers. Yeah. Tells you there's so much going on. And we wanted to make sure that, you know, that process. So we had to extend hours. We had to extend hours of orders of protection because, like I said, there is no time for someone to get abused or you know. Yeah. And so we have to make sure that the availability, and sometimes many of those individuals were doing that at 12 midnight. The person might be sleeping. So we saw that there was a lot of extended hours that were needed.
Yeah.
We addressed that. You know, we addressed the fact that we opened up a call center because a lot of calls were coming into our courthouses were not being answered. That because we were short staffed, and because there was a lot of telephone lines and no equipment at the end of those telephone lines. Mm-hmm. So we streamlined everything. Right now at the call center, we have a call center at the daily center where we have 30 plus employees who are there servicing the calls. We've already received, we opened the center up, opened the center up in June of 2023. We have already received and taken care of over 300,000 people have called our call center and have had their whatever they need help with, and we've made it available in 200 languages. So anybody calling in doesn't have to worry about a language issue because we have the interpreters, we have the system that offers over 200 languages. That alone, I mean, to know that we've already taken care of 300,000 people that have called our call center, didn't have to come to the data center, didn't have to go to a courthouse. They took care of their business right over the phone. You know, that's important.
It sounds like you've come in running.
I came in running.
If you've been doing all of this almost under duress because you had to deal, you came in during the pandemic, and you're coming in anytime it's a new administration, of course, you have to deal with change over people retiring. You just talked about hiring new people. So all type of things that you're dealing with. And in the midst of it, you know, what people really don't realize that you're really running for re-election as you're doing
Yeah, the last 3 years, you know, it's been really just laying the foundation, being able to develop a record to run on. And not so much of the fact that I want to run this, it's the fact that I want to service.
And let me clarify, and I don't mean you, of course, you
No, you I know what be, you're saying.
You
I
want to be re-elected, but, yes, but you are a public servant. And so your job is you're trying to make sure that the clerk of the circuit court, that office, is running up to speed.
Up to speed.
You know, so when that time does come, you'll get a chance to
To talk about the success of the office, about how we've turned around, how we now have also an expungement center. When you go over to 26th and California on the fifth floor, we opened up an expungement center, something that was so needed because when we went out, when we did clerk in the communities, we took that part out into the community. We went all over Cook County. Mm. Cook County, we're doing, you know,
clerk
in the communities. Yeah. So we take our employees, some of our clerks, with the equipment, all their equipment, their laptops and everything. We go, and the people can actually, from the neighborhood, you know, we'll announce that we're going to be in this neighborhood, and we welcome people from the neighborhood mm-hmm. who don't want to come to downtown or don't want to go to a courtroom mm-hmm. and are still looking about, you know, still trying to find their own personal information, mm-hmm. but are too afraid.
Yeah.
What we have had is the clerks in the community. The clerks are there. People can come. They can put they can give us their information just to see if they have any outstanding warrants, if they have any kind of legal issues that you know that might arise for them to have to take action. So we've been able to do that, and we have been able to help a lot of people.
Yes, ma'am.
Figure out, because sometimes you might have an old ticket that you might have never paid. There might be an old warrant that's in there
mm-hmm.
that might be never because you never even knew that.
Yes, ma'am.
Because 20 years later, you know, not as your warrant, but it hasn't been executed. So again, we wanted to make sure that people had access to us and any kind of information, and we've been able to be very successful in that clerk in the community because people wait for it, for us to come, and a lot of it's about expungements. They want to know about expungements. They want to know about how to file, you know, a will, how to, you know, I mean, just any kind of court services. They are able to have that clerk right there in their own community to answer whatever questions they want, and that to me was important.
I feel your passion, but you got time. You got to rush.
No, I'm trying to not forget because there's so many good things that we've
done. I know,
in that
you're trying to get it all out, but trust me, you we're gonna give you more than a couple of minutes.
All right. So,
but we do have a caller, though. I want you to hold that up. Caller, you're on the air with the clerk, Circuit Court of Cook County, I should say. Caller going once. Caller going twice. We're going to carry on with this conversation then. So, but we are talking with the clerk of the Circuit Court of Cook County. The number to call in if you do have a question or a comment is 773-434-6625. And so, but it sounds like you have more accomplishments that you want to talk about.
I think the expungement center, the call center, I think we also saw long lines of people waiting to speak to somebody, you know, one of the Karina Green folks or a legal, because they have to be, you know, they're going to self-represent. So we saw a lot of long lines of people waiting for that. We found a space in 69 West Washington in a lower level, the concourse level.
Mm-hmm.
We opened up an office for self-litigants. So anyone who needs, you know, some kind of representation, They need help because they're going to self-represent. We have the legal team, you know, that works with us there and our clerk and are able to help people prepare themselves so they can go in front of a judge because they don't have the ability to pay for a judge. At least they are able to get some kind of counseling from the legal community, or even they will help them get in front of a judge for whatever they may be. That was something that I wanted to make sure that there was also a privacy for those individuals
mm-hmm.
coming into our building and be able to go to a place that they can actually have a conversation and not in front of everybody because we don't have. And that's something that, to me, you know, the court system is such a very scary, very sensitive place, and we want to make sure that people are comfortable coming to our buildings.
It can be intimidating.
It can be very intimidating.
Yes, ma'am.
You know, and even when I walk into a courtroom, I can feel, you know, and I can see how people feel about it. But I want people to walk in and feel that they can talk to that person, and you know, that front line. That's why, to me, that front line of my clerks are very important, because they're the first point of contact with our system, and I want them to feel comfortable. I want them to feel that they're being treated, you know, with all the respect and dignity, regardless of what they're coming in for.
I've experienced that before, but my issue is before you even get up there, you had to go through the the line of sheriffs. That's where the problem is right there. But hopefully we'll have the sheriff on in the future, because sometimes I want to, man, am I on trial or what? I'm just coming to take care of something.
File some paperwork.
Man, by the
right.
time you finish right. undressing me, I'm, you know, I'm dumb. Anyway, I think that caller has returned. Caller, you on the air?
Hey, assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum salam, sir.
And good evening to your distinguished guest, Ms. Martinez.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am, I had to run across to the other side. My granddaughter's birthday. Everything happened.
Okay, we got you.
So, my question to Ms. Martinez is, there is a ton of information down there that you all control about people's lives in all manners. Like homes and whatnot in the court system. How, if you can tell me, is all that information protected? Because I asked the question because of what happened down at Lurie Children's. They're telling me now that all that information is being sold online.
Mm-hmm.
So how is it being protected down there, Ms. Martinez? I'm going to hang up and listen.
Okay.
And thank you so much
thank
for
you,
coming
sir.
On.
Thank you. One of the things that we have done, we have really modernized that office. Right now, we have actually digitized anywhere between 70 to 100 million cases have already been digitized. Mm-hmm. That information is in the system. We have worked with the cyber security and many of the, you know, the technology, I call them the technology sheriffs, the technology police,
yes, ma'am,
to make sure that the software has the most up-to-date, you know, protection. And, you know, and there has been attempts made to our office, you know, but the protection that we have of everything has been pretty solid. Mm. And again, one of the things that when I got to the office, about 3 or 4 months after I was there, our website was hacked.
Mm.
It was hacked, but it was hacked that it went to an NFL site. That probably was a guy who did that. That's what I always say. You know, that was a man who did that. He hacked that
NFL
one.
Man
right?
Football.
Yeah, yeah, men okay. in football, right. But we were able to get it captured right away, and we were able to shut it down, you know, and we did a landing page because I said, let's look at this. How outdated is this website? Sure enough, old, outdated software. That's why. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because a young lady who had come in to work for me for it saw that early on. She was a graduate from Northwestern Computer Science. And she goes, that website is very, very vulnerable. It's going to go down. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, she was right. It went down. But we were able to, redesign it and really worked with, like I said, all the security folks out there to make sure because of the sensitive cases of information that we have in our system to protect that. And we've won 2 awards, national awards, for the best redesigned website, user-friendly that it is.
Okay.
If you have a chance, go to it. And there's so much information. You can navigate through it very simply, you know. And we had, like I said, a lot of people have called our office and said, that is a great website. So, you know, we take pride in that because mm-hmm. it took us a month for us to bring it back up. But I said, let's not rush. Let's not rush through this. We have to make sure that when we bring that system back, it's because it's going to be at 100% or at least close to 100%. And technology, the sad thing about technology is you're always going to have a glitch. Technology is not ever 100% proof. I mean, it's not 100% proof. You're going to have that happen. But we've been blessed so far that we have not had anything hit our system that has brought it down or any information lost. And that's because we have worked with the very best of the best, and we continue to make sure that we are updating our information, our technology, software, as it evolves because of the fact that, you know, there's a lot of crazy people out there hacking into everything.
They got a lot of time on their hands.
Yep, yeah. They got too much time on their hands.
But, you know, you had mentioned the call that actually triggered a thought, and I want you to take the opportunity to address this. We're talking about the privacy of the young people in the hospital and everything, but there was some accusations drawn towards you as far as the juvenile records.
Right. Let me share that we're very clear. My opponent has been lying about this campaign, lying about the office. She has no information whatsoever about what really happens in that. She says she's a practicing attorney, but guess what? She has never registered through our CCC portal. So she says she's practicing, but she's never practiced through our system. So
okay.
I want people to understand that a lot of the information about this 5,000 juvenile, believe me, if anything would have been exposed, I would have been all over the news. Again, they're lies. Now, there's been a couple of incidents as for testing? Yes, that did happen. But the public defender's office, some of the public defender leaked that to the media, and the media made it sound like we had exposed. We never exposed 5,000 because we were in a test stage at the time, and only the partners, our people that we constantly work with, we said, here is, we're going to do this search, you know, this case search online. We want you to test it and see what you guys find.
Yes, ma'am.
They found, one of the attorneys found that little thing with the juvenile, but again, the records were never exposed. There was nothing out there. They found it, and we made sure that we went back and correct. That was the purpose of the testing, to make sure before we put it out to the public. Again, my opponent's using that, saying that 5,000 juvie records were exposed. Not true. It is the biggest lie that's out there. You know, and I keep saying, stop with the lies. Tell the truth about the office. Don't do a disservice to the people who work so hard in my office, those clerks that spend hours making sure that they are inputting all the information. We are the keeper of the records. Mm. That's who we are. That's who we are. We're the keeper of the records.
Yes,
we do not create the record. We just make sure that we maintain it. So whatever information is given to us, it's by the judge or the public defender, the attorneys, everybody that's working. The three people that are in that courtroom are the ones that, you know, will decide what goes into for us to put in.
Yes,
now, we will not put in anything that is not told to us. That's another accusation she's making out there. Again, we cannot make up, we cannot create a file. We cannot create, so we have to wait. We noticed what she was talking about, a felony and something. We found, again, my clerks see an absence that they might have missed, but we cannot put that information. They've got to give it to us. That's got to be put, you know, that has got to be put into the record by the judge. Mm-hmm. Then we input the information. I mean, so again, that we are just a keeper of the records. We do not create the record. But however, you know, if they don't give us the information, however, we have worked with them and say, hey, listen, you guys forgot this or you guys forgot that.
Mm-hmm.
Our clerks are very good about pointing that out. And then said, oh, yeah, we did. So in the meantime, you know, I mean, some of these little incidents that happen, you know, are just regular things that happen, but that we are on top of things. Nobody had to serve no extra time in jail. Nobody, you know, no records were exposed.
Yes, ma'am.
So again, these are just lies, again, to make, you know, make a case for why, you know, she will make a much better clerk than I will.
So you're saying it's typical Chicago politics, huh?
Ooh, yeah, but you know what? I feel we have a great office. We have a great team of people. We have, you know, the cabinet, a very diverse office, you know, that looks like Cook County. Mm-hmm. That office looks like Cook County. We have some great people that work there and people that have been around 20 and 30 years that love what they do. So when I hear, you know, my opponent, you know, talking about my office, that's a disservice to the people that serve there, you know, because they serve with pride, you know, and dignity in that office, and they love what they do. You know what I mean?
Ma'am.
And until you understand the office, don't make comments about our office.
Yes, ma'am. Before I let you, as we begin to wind down, you did mention the you have an office for the expungement. Do you still do, like, around the city, the expungements?
Yes, we're going to continue to do our clerk in the city, regardless, you know, what happens until, you know, next week. I will continue to work, because, again, my term finishes up in the 2024.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we're going to continue to work. We're continuing to do the services that we have. We're going to continue to expand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my ideas for the next term is to continue to build on what we have.
Mm-hmm.
When you hear people calling our offices or sending me emails, attorneys attorneys and judges talking about how great the system finally is, that we've turned it around.
Mm-hmm.
Something good is happening at the clerk's office.
Yes,
you know what I mean? And give us credit where credit is due. Because,
yes,
you know, what I received in that office when I got there, compared to, you know, again, which I'm going to win this election, but
yes,
if it was not, at least that office will be handed to the next person in a much better shape than what I received it.
Understood.
Because we have spent 3.5 years trying to redo, restructure, and just, you know, just give that office the lift it needed to make sure that we lifted that cloud that was hanging over our office forever, you know, and this issue about corruption and everything, that's got to stop.
Yeah.
That's got to stop, and it did stop with me because we made sure that everything, they were following the employment plan, they were following our Shackman rules, they were doing everything by the book, but that we are also, you know, being as, you know, as innovative as we possibly can when it comes to technology, when it comes to, you know, advancing, you know, finding advancements in the different, because one of the things we're going to do, we finally got all of our divisions are online. So all areas of law are now fully integrated.
Mm.
So the old system, I had to go from the old system into the new system. And those were millions and millions of cases that had to be transferred from one system to the new system without no glitches.
Mm.
That was the important thing. You know, that nothing got lost, nothing, you know, nothing came down, nothing, you know, went crazy. We were able to do this, you know, be able to put all areas of law, and we did a great job in making sure that nothing, you know, dramatic happened where in the past you would always see, you know, the rollouts, when the rollouts were happening, you would see some kind of problem, you know, with it. But we have been really, really blessed and with the people that I've had, you know, around me. And it's sad because I see some of these employees that we let go because of fraud, because of the PPP loans. We see, and what do we see right now? We see my opponent, with the same people that I got rid of. And again, if she wants to bring back what we had to let go of in that office to make that office work the way it should. There was people there that were just, again, they got caught up in the frauds. Mm. We got rid of them because we had to do, these are officers of the law. I mean, we're officers of the court. We're there, we take an oath. When you can take the job, you take an oath.
Yes, ma'am.
And to me, I take that very seriously. And if you fraud the federal government, you have no place in our office. Mm. Now, those same folks are walking around and giving misinformation to my opponent. That's what she comes up with things. That sometimes I said, that information is coming from the disgruntled employees that were fired. Now they're giving her advice. And I hope that people see this for what it is, mm-hmm. you know, is the fact that, you know, we don't want to go back to where it used to be. We want to make sure that we keep moving forward.
Yeah, and your point is that you've accomplished a lot, but you still have more work to do, and you just need the opportunity to complete
your... To continue to work. And I ask the people listening and everyone out there that, you know, allow me another term.
We'll take a moment and look in the camera and, you know, tell the people why they need to re-elect you and make sure you give out your information, your punch number and everything.
Well, first of all, my punch number is 91.
91.
You know, it's 91. And I came in 3.5 years determined to turn that office around. I was voted in by, you know, 1.5 million people voted for me in that last election, you know, the general election. And that said, they put a mandate on me about changing the tradition of that office, the direction that office was headed. And we've done exactly that. We have turned everything around. And for that reason, go to my website, look at all the accomplishments with the expungement center, with the domestic violence center, the things that we've been able to do in the short 3.5 years that we've been there. Mm. You can imagine how much more. We have so many ideas. We have so many thoughts on how we can continue to expand our services, but more important is also get the feedback from the people who access our office, because this is their office. This is not my office. It's the office of the people. So I'm always looking for suggestions. I'm looking for ideas. We're always partnering with people out there, with all kinds of community groups out there when it comes to expungement, when it comes to just general information, you know, about our office. We are doing just that. I think people now know what the Office of the Circuit Court does, because we've been able to do these communities, these clerks in the communities, we've been able to do a website with all the information and people can actually go through a system, you know, a very user-friendly, system that even, you know, people are very intimidated by computers still, you know, especially the older folks like me. Good thing I have a good team. But, you know, I just ask the voters to give me an opportunity to continue the work, that judge me on what the work that I've done, not by the politics that are being played out there, because there's some real. The party did not endorse me last time, and you know what? And they didn't endorse me this time. Mm. You know, and again, I beat the party last time. With your help, I'm going to beat the party again, because I'm a very independent person who I believe in the people. I believe in the people and do the work of the people,
yes, ma'am.
Not a dictatorship that right now I see happening in that party. So,
well, I thank you for this abbreviated time, and you're welcome back. We wish you the best of luck out there on the campaign trail. I thank you so much.
Thank you for having me here.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, either which way it goes, you have a platform here with us. So,
ready to come back and continue to work with you.
So there it is. So on behalf of Clerk Martinez, we're going to go ahead and take this message, and we're going to come back and finish up the show with Alderman David Moore. So we'll be back.
My name is Carmela Muhammad, owner of the Fruity Spot Restaurant and the new Let's Eat to Live restaurant. So what you can expect at both of our restaurants? Healthy and clean food with a soulful twist. Halal meat, non-genetic modified vegetables, and wild-caught fish. So visit us at the Fruity Spot at 7350 South Stony Island Avenue and Let's Eat to Live at 621 East 67th Street.
Going block by block, that's how we'll make property taxes more fair. That's what Larry Rogers Jr. is doing, hosting hundreds of community meetings to give residents a say, leading efforts to reform and modernize assessments, to hold politicians accountable, and help fight unfair tax bills, no matter where you live. Senator Dick Durbin, Congresswoman Robin Kelly, Attorney General Kwame Raoul, and local leaders agree. Larry Rogers Jr. is the best choice for Cook County Board of Review.
Eat and Run Chicken and Fish has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mother's and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order, or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
And we are back to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm Brother Mandene T. Muhammad, and I want to thank the Clerk of the Circuit Court of Cook County, Ms. Iris Y. Martinez, for joining us. Finishing up this half is my brother, Alderman David Moore. He's the alderman in the committeeman of the 17th Ward, the great 17th Ward. He's got a historic history over there.
Absolutely.
So welcome back, man.
Thank you. Good to see you,
man.
My
good
brother.
To see you. Seems like I just saw you Sunday.
All right. Yes, sir. Yeah, we had a wonderful time, man.
Man. Look,
that food is so good. You don't like to cater for me. Who is that cater, man?
Friendship.
Everything was delicious.
Oh man, we friendship in all walks of life, man. You know, we try to make sure we got people that we can call upon that bless us with good food. So we're glad you enjoyed yourself,
and
man.
They may have to serve us for our campaign victory party.
Oh man, we'll hook you up. We'll put you in touch, man. But hey, man, look, man. Again, thank you for your continued support.
Absolutely.
Of us, man. I really appreciate that. And on behalf of the organization, we really appreciate that. So, but look, man, you in the heat of it now, man.
You're in the heat of it,
you
man.
Got it's politics. You, as you say, you run as if you're losing, man. But
absolutely.
you big enough to, you know, support others as well, man. I've seen the palm cards, and I see how you push your stomp for others as well, but. And sometimes we forget that you're actually running for something right now yourself, man.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you won your re-election as a
alderman.
As alderman, but mm-hmm. people often forget about the committeeman position.
Which is a very critical position as well. And as you all saw, Clerk Iris Martinez, it's important that we select candidates, and that's part of being the committeeman, that we select candidates that are going to bring resources to our community and help our community. If we got some new listeners out there, new viewers, or just people letting people know, you know, you got the alderman and you got the committeeman. The alderman is the paid position where you serve everybody regardless of party, regardless of religion, mm-hmm. regardless if they don't even vote for you. You got to make sure that their streets and the services that they need, their alleys, their garbage is picked up, whatever they need, and advocate for them as well at city council. The other thing is that the committeeman is the unpaid position. Mm-hmm. And that's the position where we get the people to come out to vote. What we're doing in the 17th Ward is what we're working on is doing a collective vote, not just voting in high number, but making sure we got a collective vote, because that's what the power is. And that's what we've been doing in the 17th Ward is around the committeeman, but also making sure the people had a voice. Some committeemen go behind closed doors and select candidates with the Cook County Democratic Party, mm-hmm. which is fine in some cases. Me, I bring it to my residents. I bring the people out to my residents.
Right.
And before we decide on people, we say, hey, we have them talk to our residents, and then we have our residents vote on who they want me right. to support. So what you're talking about on my palm card, when you see Clerk Iris Martinez, I didn't decide on her. The people did. And it's me up as the committeeman to listen to the people. Well, when you see Larry Rogers on my sample ballot, I didn't decide on Larry Rogers. The people did.
Mm-hmm.
And so on and on and on. State Representative Mary Flowers, who we have to make sure during this Women History Month that we don't allow people to come after a black woman who's mm-hmm. doing a good job.
Yeah.
And so those are the people that I've been supporting. And unfortunately, my opponent, when they asked him he was on the radio, why do you want to be committeeman? He should have just been honest and said, because I want to be alderman.
Mm-hmm.
He just got elected to the seat of Senate, luckily, and Now he's looking, trying to unseat me. Hmm. So he told me he's going to take the committeeman seat from me, then come back and take my aldermanic seat. I was like, well, number one, it's not my seat. Hmm. It's the people's seat. So I serve at the will of the people. And so we're going to continue to do the good things we're doing in the 17th Ward. The people that I put in as the committeemen, or that I support as the committeemen, is because they're bringing resources so we can get more streets done, more sidewalks done, so we can do development like we're doing on 79th and Halsted and 79th and Green, like we did on 71st and Western, like we're doing on 71st and Kedzie, and like I'm pushing the mayor now to do on 69th Street between Ashland and Damon. So in 8 years that we've been in office, we've accomplished that because of the relationships and the type of people that I supported. And he wants to come in and try to divide the House of the 17th Ward. You're not going to do that.
Let me ask you this. In respect to the committeeman seat, because it was a few aldermen who either, you know, decided not to run or later changed their mind or, you know, didn't quite get enough signatures, you know, different reasons. So they just kind of played it down. And it's like when you think about back in the days, you know, the committeemanship was really, you know, something of importance that people didn't really play around with. I think it was only maybe a couple of aldermen that, you know, kind of figured it was no big deal. And then right. They went on to regret that thought process. But why is it that some of your peers have decided, you know, to just kind of play it down a little bit?
They didn't. Some of them didn't make the ballot.
They didn't.
You know, back in the day, if you don't have an organization to help you go door to door and get signatures, because when you were the committeeman back in the day, and it was also attached to the alderman, you had the jobs at the county, you had the jobs at the city, and so you had those jobs that you could give them. But when Shackman came through, all of that was eliminated, and so you don't have those jobs that you can give your organization people to get out there and get those signatures for you. I've done it a different way, not just depending. I help people get jobs, but that's not because you're going out there getting signatures for me. We work with our community. That's why it's called the 17th Ward Democratic Community Organization. It's the community out there. They dictate to me. They say this is what we want and this is what we don't want. And therefore, they stand with me and help me get my signatures and do all of those things so that they put in the people that they want to put in.
Yeah.
And that's what it's all about. And so when you look at it, the alderman is always the committee. In some cases, like when Stroger was the county commissioner and the president of the board, he was also the committeeman, but he controlled his what? Alderman, because he selected them.
Mm-hmm.
Mike Madigan, he was the state representative, but he was also the committeeman, but he chose his alderman.
Mm.
He managed them. And then Secretary Jesse White, when he was Secretary of State, he was also the committeeman, but he chose his alderman, which was Walter Burnett. And so we're still a house together. He's trying to come in and divide the house. A house divided will fall. And we're not going to let anyone come in and divide this house. And it was even more just disheartening. And I tell people, stop electing people because they scream the loudest and they run for office. If you ain't seen nobody before they ran for office, don't be keep putting these people in office and stuff like that, because these are people who have self-interest. This is a man who started a company, a construction company, and he's being sued right now. So he's being sued right now. So he want to run for my position as alderman, thinking he can get committee, then run for my position as alderman to make more money. I didn't get in this to get paid for this. I was made for this. Mm-hmm. And so we got to stop getting people in office to help their own self-interest and everything.
Let me ask you this, because you mentioned a couple of times, and you've always said this, that it's the people who put you in.
That's right.
You know, it's the people the people that's on your palm card are the people that the citizens
chose. Absolutely.
How important is it that you keep the people informed, educate the voters informed, educate them? Is that, you know, because a lot of people, sometimes, you know, I think some politicians, they prefer ignorant voters.
They want an ignorant voter base, so they can pull stuff, not only pull stuff over their eyes, but a lot of people get in office. Like right now, he has on his sample ballot that he's the committeeman.
Oh.
That's a disrespect to the community who elected me and who I've been serving. You haven't. So I you. Mean, so that, in other words,
that's almost like that's so like lying.
It
right?
is. It ain't no. It ain't like lying. It is lying.
I'm trying to be.
It is lying. Yes, so if you lie to get in office and do anything to get in office, you lie and do anything to stay in office. And so when you hear me say this in my residence, they bring their books to my community meetings because I tell them I'm here to inform, educate, and empower you. I don't want the power. I want my residents to have the power. Because one day, I won't be here. One day, I'm going to step to the side. You understand? Mm. But I want my residents to be in power so that whoever come in that seat, they're like, no, no, no. We wag you. You don't wag us. Mm. And so that's what I want. That's what it's all about. Informing, educating, and empowering our residents. And when they're informing, educating, and empowered in a smart electorate, then we can get the resources that we're getting in our community. We hadn't had no investment over here in years. Mm-hmm. And in eight short years, here we are doing the things that we're doing in the 17th Ward. New football field at Ogden Park. New development for public housing and bringing a restaurant. New metro station with the help of State Senator Jackie Collins. New Roops to Roo gas station that promotes reading. One of the best in the city. You don't see no hanging out at that gas station. Yeah, it's a very true. Nice. It's a very nice gas station. And so these are the things that we're doing and we're going to continue to do.
And we are talking with Alderman and Committeeman David Moore of the 17th Ward. And he's seeking your re-election as committeeman.
That's right.
And I think, again, they're part of educating the voters, because a lot of people, you know, you hear often like, man, I just voted for you. I mean,
what's going on?
But again, this is your opportunity again to educate like this. The run is not over with. The job is not done yet.
It's not done.
You know, they need to go back there. I don't even know where that's positioned at on the ballot, you know.
It's the last one on the ballot.
Is it after the judges?
It's after the judges.
That's how disrespectful that is. So, I mean, they're mistreating the judges, the people that most of the time, we're going to either see the alderman or the judge.
Right.
But they got y'all in the back.
The committeeman is the last one on the ballot, absolutely.
But talk about the importance of, one, the educated voter to go through the whole ballot.
You have to.
Yeah.
You have to, because if you don't, number one, you end up getting people, and a no vote for somebody is even a vote for the person you may not want to get in office. So it's very important that you go to the entire ballot, and especially our sample ballot that we have. And if you need a sample ballot, please go to my Facebook page or call my office at 773-846-0289. Leave your address. But we've passed them out all over the ward. But 773-846-0289, call us. Get a yard sign or get a sample ballot, and we got all the judges that you need to vote for. Mm-hmm. And it's very important, because no matter if we pass legislation, just like you're seeing with even the Bring Home Chicago ordinance, it was a judge that overturned it, mm-hmm. and then the appellate judge flipped their decision. Mm-hmm. And so the judges have the last say-so. So it's important that we select the judges. It's the judges that are deciding whether Trump is going to be on the ballot. Mm-hmm. So the legislature can say one thing, but it's those judges. So that's why it's important to go to each one. And don't forget the committeeman. Punch 171. Punch 171 and keep David Moore as your committeeman.
Let's talk more about that development that's going on in the 17th Ward. Like you mentioned, 79th in the house there. But, I mean, we see cranes.
We see cranes
on the south side of Chicago, man.
That's
something that we're not used to seeing. So do we know what's coming there? I mean, we see the development. It looks great,
as far as the activity. Yeah.
But what's going on?
Man, we should be done with it. Fall probably won't be opening until ribbon cutting until spring. And it's looking good. And I'm trying to get some more funding from the city to build out the sit-down restaurant that's going to go there, as well as the Play It Again store for sports equipment for kids who cannot afford the expensive bats or the expensive gloves, and then some new but gently used sports equipment at that store. It's going to also be an African food store selling groceries, but it's also going to have groceries non-African, but which is just thankful for this brother that's opening that store there.
So, 17 Ward getting a grocery store again.
It's a smaller one, but they're getting one.
Everything
helps. That brings some fresh fruits and vegetables and other products to our community. We got the Save a Lot by Yellow Banana that's going to be reopening in April. We have the Jerk Villa sit down restaurant.
That looks like a huge place.
It's going to be huge. Also, a little bar we can go in and just, you know, relax and stuff like that, so we can have places to go to in our community. So there's just so much that we're doing in the 17th Ward, and we cannot go backwards for somebody who can't even run his own business, that's getting sued, for somebody that has not brought a dollar to the 17th Ward and bringing infrastructure dollars like State Representative Mary Flowers is doing and like State Senator Jackie Collins did. We can't afford to go back. We're too far ahead. And we definitely can't go to back for somebody that's being controlled by someone.
Yeah. Talk again, because I know I saw an article in the Crusader featuring you and Senator Mattie Hunter defending Representative Flowers. And it seemed like it's, I actually saw a commercial. Mm-hmm. I don't think I've ever seen a commercial for State Rep.
You have, when they came after Ken Duncan.
Oh, that's what it was.
Yeah, you have. Yeah. You have.
You had a sitting president.
You had a sitting president.
That's something, man.
Right.
You're absolutely correct.
And the reason why he did it, because he spoke up against Madigan at that time.
And Madigan made a phone call.
Madigan made a phone call. This is the same thing that's happening here. Our sitting state rep spoke up, and they don't like the way she talked when she say, "What's in it for the black people?" Or, "How is that going to help black people?" They're saying she offend her other colleagues down there when she talked like that. Mm. Come on, man. Mm. And so you got someone standing up, somebody that got institutional knowledge, and they can't pull that wool over her ass because she's been down there and she knows what's going on. Same thing with Congressman Danny Davis. People don't understand. They're talking about he's too old. His mind is still sharp.
Yeah.
Number one, his mind is still sharp.
Yeah.
Number two, he has seniority down there. Anybody else that gets elected has to start all over. He's been down there. He's been in Congress for over, I think, 20 years, almost 30, probably 25 years for sure, maybe 30. He's been in Congress, and he's still number 77 of all the Congress and number, I think, 11 among Democrats. He doesn't even have a chairmanship yet, because chairmanship is done by seniority. But guess what? He sits on the Powerful Ways and Means Committee that bring those, he gets to make sure those dollars are coming to our community. Anybody else go there going to have to wait a what? Another 30, 40 years to get to his spot. People got to understand this. Stop. Please stop. Please stop. Cutting your nose off to spite your face. Listen, you all, and that's why people end up keep saying, no matter who in office, we keep getting the same thing, because you all keep getting this, you guys not listening. Listen to somebody that's doing something. Listen to somebody that don't have anything to lose. I'm not in this thing for self-gratification or for power like my opponent is. I'm in here because I got a track record. Before I even became alderman, I had a track record for serving in this community. People say, "Man, we thought you was already elected." No, it's because I've served, you know, and it's important to keep these people in office.
Well, I can't say this about you. I've been knowing you for over a couple of decades now. I guess it's safe to say and that gray shows it. But you've definitely been in the community, man. And we mentioned this times before, and I try to reflect back, because I don't know if it was 17 Ward, CHA, or what, but you've always been in the community, so it's in your blood. So, and again, I always have to quote the great Roland Burris when he talks about the difference between a politician and a public servant.
A big difference, and that's what you're getting at this opponent of mine, a politician. And you know, you can tell them when they're politicians, when they don't have a record to stand on, and they just put out negative ads. They just put out a negative ad about me that they can't even stand on. You know, and thinking our electorate is that stupid. And I was, you know, and the human part of you want to respond to it, right? But when you're praying, man, when God has put you in a place that would you have, he's put you in, you just sit back and you say, you handle it. And guess what? Several of my constituents called me. They got that in that mail today. Oh, they're furious because they know the work. My work speaks for itself. My work speaks for itself. I don't need nobody to call on my behalf. Oh, vote for David Moore. I'm the leader of this community. And those residents, those people I listen to, they're my bosses. Mm-hmm. And so when I listen to them and they know I listen to them, when I serve them and they know I serve them, they stand with me. Yes. And that's what they're doing.
Look, man, we only got less than 2 minutes left. Man. So I want you to take the opportunity to look in that camera and present your case yet again on why you should be retained as the committeeman of the 17th Ward.
Absolutely. First and foremost, the 17th Ward committeeman is tied to the aldermanic office. And you do not want an aldermanic office that's divided. A house divided will fall. And remember, people should be seen doing work, not doing work to be seen. And so please punch 171, re-elect me as your committeeman of the 17th Ward so that we can continue to do the things we do. Punch 171. If you need a sample ballot, please call 773-846-0289. Again, that number is 773-846-0289. And we'll make sure our office gets you a sample ballot. So you can go early vote at Thurgood Marshall Library. And if you don't know everything, trust your own research. But more than that, see the work that we're doing in the community.
So, hey, look, there it is, my brother. Thank you so much for joining us.
I appreciate you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good luck out there on the campaign trail. And so on behalf of Clerk Martinez, Iris Martinez, on behalf of Brother Alderman David Moore, on behalf of the CROE co-founders and CROE membership, the CROE media production team, I'm Brother Mandene T. Muhammad. May Allah continue to bless you with the light of understanding as I greet you in peace. As-salamu alaykum.